Hey everybody, this is the first in a short series of videos to introduce the fundamentals of probability. In this video, we're going to discuss three definitions for probability and determine how to use them. Probability is the study of random phenomenon. This branch of mathematics has a rather dubious origin in that almost all of the early work in the field dealt with problems in gambling. But now probability serves as a fundamental tool for all types of scientific endeavors, such as deciding if a new drug is safe for the public, or if a hurricane is going to hit our coastline, determining the likelihood if you'll be in a car accident, predicting the outcome of elections, or just whether somebody's going to make the next free throw. So what do we mean by a random phenomenon? Random phenomena is one which may assume any one of multiple states, but the particular state that's going to assume next cannot be predicted with complete certainty. We don't know for certain what will happen next, but probability gives us tools to determine what is likely to occur. There's three basic terms you need to familiarize yourself with in the study of probability. An experiment is the act of performing a random phenomena and observing the outcome. The sample space is the set of all possible outcomes, and an event is any subset of a sample space. So let's consider some simple examples. Suppose we start by rolling a standard pair of six-sided dice. Since the outcome is random, rolling the dice and seeing what appears on the top would be our experiment. The sample space would be the set of all possible outcomes. Since there are six outcomes for the first die and six outcomes for the second die, there should be 6 times 6 or 36 possible outcomes. You can see all of them listed in the table here below. Now there's numerous events we might want to consider related to this sample space. For instance, one event might be rolling a sum of 5. You can see that there's 4 elements in our sample space that meet this criteria. So our event would be the subset consisting of these 4 elements. Likewise, the subset for rolling doubles would have 6 elements, and the subset for rolling at least 1 3 would have 11 elements. Another example of a random phenomenon would be to flip 3 coins in the air and determine the number of heads and tails that appear. Since there's 2 outcomes for each coin, there's 2 times 2 times 2, or 8 elements in our sample space. 3 possible events you might find of interest are shown here. They're getting all heads, which occurs in 1 of our 8 cases. Getting a single head occurs 3 ways in our sample space, and getting at least 2 tails occurs 4 different ways. What we're going to be primarily concerned with is the likelihood or probability that one of these events might occur. Our first definition is the most common and the easiest to use, but it comes with a pretty hefty restriction. It says if all outcomes in our sample space are equally likely, then the probability of event E, which we'll denote by P of E, is given by the cardinality of E divided by the cardinality of our sample space. Cardinality is just the number of elements in our set, so this means it's the number of ways that E can occur divided by the number of things that might occur. The big restriction here is that all outcomes must be equally likely. Consider our example with the pair of six-sided die. If the dice are fair, then all our outcomes are equally likely. So the probability of the event rolling a sum of 5 would be the number of ways you can get a 5 divided by the number of things you might roll. In this case, there's 4 ways to roll a 5 and 36 things you might roll, so the probability would be 4 over 36, or 1/9. Some people prefer working with decimals or percents, which is fine, but you do need to watch out for round-off error. Similarly, the probability of rolling doubles would be 6 out of 36, or 1/6, and the probability of rolling at least 1/3 would be 11/36. We can consider a more difficult problem, but first you need to remember your formula for choosing R items from a set of N items. Our combination formula says that N choose R is given by N factorial divided by N minus R factorial R factorial. In this example, we want to find the probability that choosing 5 cards from a deck will yield a flush in hearts. That is 5 cards that are all hearts. Since there's 13 hearts, the number of ways to get a flush would be 13 choose 5. And since there's 52 cards, the sample space would be all possible 5-card hands, which would be 52 choose 5. Plugging these in and simplifying, we get 33 divided by 66,640. So what does this probability mean? If we go back to our example with the dice, what does it mean to say the probability of rolling doubles is 1/6? Does this mean that if you roll the dice 6 times, that one of the rolls should be doubles? No. It means that if you continually repeat this experiment, that roughly 1/6 of the time you should get doubles. So this leads us to our second definition for probability. If an experiment is repeated multiple times, then the probability of event E can be estimated by the number of times that E occurs divided by the number of trials or experiments. This formula does not require equally likely outcomes, as in a previous one, and is in fact the method we use most often for estimating probabilities in the real world. There is a property in probability known as the law of large numbers, which states that the more times an experiment is performed, the closer your empirical estimate will get to the actual probability. While this may sound intuitively obvious, it is in fact quite difficult to prove. Example time. First, consider throwing a small paper cup in the air. The sample space for how it could land would be the small bottom, the side, and the large top. However, these are not equally likely, so we couldn't use our original definition. So instead, we use our new definition and just keep repeating the experiment. In this case, after 130 flips, it landed once on the bottom, 123 times on the side, and 6 times on the top. So our estimate for the probability the cup lands on the top would be, say, 6 out of 130. If we wanted to improve this estimate, we only need to perform more experiments. A more real-life example can be seen in genetics. When Gregor Mendel was justifying his theory about dominant and recessive genes, he was able to confirm his results using probability theory. According to his theory, if two plants containing both genes were crossed, then 3/4 of the time you should get the dominant trait, and 1/4 of the time the recessive. In this case, the trait was color, and green was dominant to yellow. One round of 428 experiments resulted in 152 yellow peas, so the probability of yellow is equal to 152 divided by 428, which is 0.262, which is very close to the 1/4 or 0.25 that he predicted. We have one more definition for probability to consider, and this one is useful for providing a theoretical result in infinite and non-uniform cases. This requires the idea of a measurement function. A function m is said to be a measurement function for a set S if it behaves the way we normally think of measuring things. The measurement gives us some positive number, and the bigger our sets get, the bigger our measurement becomes. We'll typically use standard measures like length, area, volume, or angle measure. So our final definition says if m is a measurement function for some sample space S, then the probability of some event E, which is a subset of S, is given by the measure of E divided by the measure of S. Consider the example of the non-uniform dartboard shown here. If we assume a dart is equally likely to hit the board anywhere, then we can use the area of each region to determine our probability. The area of the whole board is 10 by 10 times 10, or 100 square units. We can find the area of each triangular region using the area equals 1/2 base times the height. So the area of region A, for instance, would be 1/2 times 4 times 5, which is 10. Hence, the probability of hitting A would be 10 over 100, or 1/10. Now suppose we created a non-uniform spinner. In this case, we can take our measurement function to be the angle measure that defines each region. The total possible measurement would be 360 degrees. So for instance, the probability of spinning a 3 would be the angle measure of region 3, which is 45 degrees, divided by the total. So the probability of the spinner landing on 3 would be 45 over 360, or 1/8. So in summary, probability is the likelihood of some random event occurring. We have given three basic definitions for the probability of an event. For equally likely sample spaces, we use the cardinality of E divided by the cardinality of S. For a measurable set S, we can say that it's the measure of E divided by the measure of S. And for empirical data, we have the number of times E occurs divided by the number of trials. So good luck, and thanks for watching.